This is Pittsburgh Vanity today. Halleck writes, this army is undisciplined and very much disorganized. The officers are being utterly incapable of maintaining order. I'm going to take command. I'm going to rip this army back into condition. He's a micromanager. He even starts cutting orders, telling the cooks what temperature to cook the food. Now, that's micromanagement. He gets way down there. How deep you dig your latrines, all of these things, as he's trying to maintain order. You will accumulate an army of over 100,000 men. Beauregard always retreating back with his men. He retreats back to Corinth. He gets back. I remember it took him 3 days to get up there, but there's no motivation, so they get back in one day. And Halleck begins to accumulate an army. Brings in John Pope's army off the Mississippi River, forms his left wing. He has Buell's men form the center wing. And he gets George Thomas's men, they bring in, they form the right wing, and he gets an army of over 100,000 soldiers. And 104,162 men, as you see. And then Halleck, remember I mentioned last week, he's a man who likes to make haste slowly. Halleck decides, okay, we don't want to risk being defeated, even though we're outnumbered in 2-1, and we're quick. So we will move a half a mile and dig in. We'll move a half mile and dig in. It's a long time to move 18 miles that way. And on the 29th of April, they start moving. And that's as slow as a computer let me have that ever move. And they arrive a month later on the 30th of May in Corinth. It takes them a month to move 20 miles. Of course, this is, and the Confederates, all they do is they go to get on the train and skedaddle. They go down to Tupelo. There's nobody to stop them, so they just load up and get on the train. And Halleck writes, I have won the victory without the battle. I have captured Corinth, and I haven't had to have a battle. Boy, this is Belisarius. This is just great stuff. He's forgotten that the mission of the army is to seek out and destroy the other man's army, not to capture a piece of dirt. Halleck is a realtor. He's wearing a realtor's patch on his uniform, he thinks. Now let's take a look at what's happening on the Mississippi River right quick before we take a break. The 25th of February, as Grant is moving down the Tennessee River, we've got John Pope's runner. Remember, we saw him in Corinth. John Pope's moving down. The Confederates have moved down, and they've built fortifications at New Madrid, Island Number 10, Fort Pillow, and Memphis on the Mississippi River. John Pope's men are going to move down and capture New Madrid on the 14th of March, 1862. Flag Officer Foote, remember him? Foote is the man who took Rogers' job. Foote has been wounded in the foot at Fort Donelson, and he's still suffering from that wound, but he's still in command right now. Right? That's the wound I mentioned to you. It'll take him about a year to kill him. But he's still suffering from that wound he got at Fort Donelson from a shell that hit his gunboat. Here's a close-up of Island Number 10. You see the Confederate fortifications on the island here. We've also got Confederate batteries here. The Confederates have captured New Madrid, and here's the Federal fleet out here with Foote. Foote had commanded a walk of the Carondelet with the red smokestacks, run the batteries on the latter 4 inches. A huge light missile. He runs past the batteries, joins up with the army there, and they say, okay, well, what's the purpose of that? He runs down below, hits the Confederate batteries there on the 6th of April, moves ashore, and spikes the guns. Now, guess what? They're in front of and behind the Confederates at Island Number 10. It's an untenable position. Pretty slick move. Took the Navy to do it. I'm an Army guy. I hate to say it. Took the Navy to do it, folks. So the commander there on the 8th of April tries to pull back, General Mackle, and guess what? He is surrounded, has to wave the white flag, and Island Number 10 falls. Okay, they're going to move down towards Fort Pillow. However, Foote's wounds are going to be too bad, and Flag Officer Davis is going to take his position. Davis will be here on the Mississippi River for a while with the Ironclad Fleet. So the Ironclad Fleet has gone for this ever-tiny moment. John Rogers had the Timberclads, but he never got the Ironclads. Then Foote gets the Ironclads, and now Davis has got the Ironclads, and eventually we're going to see Porter with him when we get down here. But right now, Davis has got it. They move downriver, they get into a naval battle at Fort Cullen. Get popped away, the USS Cincinnati is hit by shell fire and sunk. The first of the ironclads to be sunk. It's of course, it's raised, but it's sunk there at Fort Cullen. The Mound City is damaged. Catches some rounds and gets severely damaged. So the shell fire is quite active there. Meanwhile, Halleck, if you recall, has moved into Corinth on the 30th of May, and when the Confederates up here at Fort Pillow realize that they have been flanked and the enemy is now behind them, they skedaddle on the 4th of June, 1862, in Fort Pillow, and then the Federals will move down to Memphis. And again, the Federals are over here and behind here, so this puts Memphis in a precarious situation. But we're going to see also a naval battle at Memphis on the 6th of June, 1862. The Confederates have put together a hodgepodge fleet. The Federals have not only ironclads, but a ram fleet, commanded by Colonel Charles Millet, a superb civil engineer, a man who understood the Mississippi River probably as good as James Buchanan in his book, but we'll never know because he gets killed. Now, one of the few Federal casualties at the naval battle of Memphis. But the Confederate River fleet is virtually destroyed by these ironclads. And that pretty much ends on Mississippi River any real Confederate threat, with the exception of one boat we'll talk about later on. We'll see that things up. The fleet is pretty much gone. Take a quick look here. What's happened from the 6th of February at Fort Henry all the way to the 6th of June in Memphis. You'll see the red spots, the Confederates, the Yanks have moved down. The Tennessee River captured Fort Henry. The Cumberland River captured Fort Donelson on the 6th and 16th February. They have taken over Columbus on the 4th of March and Bowling Green on the 14th of February, so they're moving inexorably down to the south. They captured Nashville, Tennessee, the first of the southern capitals to fall on the 25th of February, 1862. They moved down the Tennessee River, fight the Battle of Shiloh on 6th, 7th April. Move into Corinth, capture Corinth on the 30th of May. Coming down the Mississippi River, New Madrid, island number 10 on the 14th of March and the 8th of April. Fort Pillow, 10th of May, they fight the naval battle, and then the 4th of June, Fort Pillow is evacuated after they find out the Federals are behind them in Corinth. The Federal fleet moves down to Memphis, Tennessee on the 6th of June, fights the naval battle, destroys the fleet. Raise the stars and stripes at Memphis, Tennessee. Now, all of a sudden, look at what's happened. This huge piece of territory is now under federal control. Not only this real estate, but more importantly, the railroads and the rivers are now in Union hands. And this means they have some relatively secure lines of communication. Grant's going to make a tactical error. We're going to see he's going to use his railroads as a line of communication. And railroads are very good servants, but poor masters of the war. You can get pretty badly by using a railroad by communication. It's the rivers they're going to support. So this huge piece of territory has fallen from February to June of 1862, and the Confederates have now had to form a new line. All right, here's my pictogram. It's nowhere near as complicated as last week. Who can tell me what that says?
Great comment.
Break time! Okay, we've got the chief of staff has got cokes and cookies out for you. So, I've broken them down in front of them, trying to do all of it simultaneously. We get so mixed up, we never follow that thing. So, we've done the north, let's come from the south. First of all, let's go back and see where the plan to capture New Orleans evolves. On the 12th of November, 1861, Washington, D.C. You notice that we used to be a canal there where the mall is today, a mosquito infested trench. Sewage and whatever, but you see that finished on. Commander David Dixon Porter meets with Secretary of the Navy Gideon Wells and Assistant Secretary of the Navy Gus Fox on the 12th of November 1861. And according to Porter, Commander Porter says, I gave the Secretary my opinion of the importance of capturing New Orleans and my plans for doing so. They like the idea, they go to see the President. The President says, this should have been done sooner. The Mississippi is the backbone of the whole rebellion. It is the key to the whole situation. Somehow, when you get up to Gettysburg, those statements are lost, are they not? They are lost. And I tell you what, if you ever repeat that up at Gettysburg, you will be invited to leave town quickly. So. This enters Flag Officer David Glasgow Farragut. Farragut is 60 years old. Still, he's like Jack Palance. He likes to do one-handed push-ups to show everybody what great physical condition he stays in. Born in Tennessee, so they're not quite sure whether to trust him or not, but he was adopted by David Dixon Porter's father in 1808. Farragut joins the Navy at age 9. You heard me, age 9, on 17 December 1810. He's the foster brother of David Dixon Porter, and also the foster brother of William Porter, known as Dirty Bill. Dirty Bill was court-martialed in 1855. The charges were so extravagant, after that he was known as Dirty Bill. Had nothing to do with his personal hygiene. He's going to be assigned as the flag officer of the Western Gulf Blockading Squadron, 9 January 1862. He will be the man who's going to command this expedition. Coming along with him is going to be his foster brother, David Dixon Porter. Porter, if you believe him, he is the guy who recommended Farragut for this job. Yet Gus Fox will ask him to keep an eye on Farragut and report back to me what he's doing, because he was born in Tennessee, but not real sure about his foster brother or not. And so his own brother, his own foster brother, David Dixon Porter, is sending secret messages back to the Secretary of Navy, or the Assistant Secretary of Navy, on whether or not this man can be trusted. Lots of intrigue here. Son of Corporal David Porter, born in Pennsylvania. He joined the Mexican Navy with his dad at the age of 12. So both of these, neither one of these guys were Annapolis grads, but they have been around a long time in the Navy. Joined the U.S. Navy at age 15, 1829. He's the brother of Dirty Bill Porter and the foster brother of David Glasgow Farragut. He is going to command a mortar flotilla. Now, these are not mortar scows that we're going to see later on. These are actually schooners with mortars mounted on the decks, steam-powered schooners. One problem they're going to have is these 17,000-pound mortars, when they fire, they're going to rip the decks of these schooners apart. And that lasted terribly long. The recoil of these things was really, really a real problem. Porter is convinced that he can capture New Orleans capture Forts Jackson, St. Philip with his mortars. Now, I wanted to show you the traveling patterns because I wanted to show you, even though they're foster brothers, there's going to be a little bad blood between the two. You can't get two type A foster brothers together and not have problems. Okay? So Farragut is going to leave Hampton, Virginia on his flagship, the Hartford, on the 2nd of February, 1862, go all the way down to Key West, Florida. Arrives on the 12th of February, and he's expecting to meet Porter there. Porter ain't there. Farragut type A, that day he didn't like that at all. So type A can't stay still. So what's he going to do? He says, well, I'll tell you what I'll do. I will shoot down from Key West. Let's put it just getting down to Key West again. I'll shoot down to Havana. See what the heck's going on down there. Maybe they pick up a cigar while I'm there. He goes down to Havana, leaves there on Key West on the 15th of February. Goes down to Havana, stays there for a couple of days. And while he's there, he gets really ticked off as he sees the Confederacy is loading cotton bale after cotton bale after cotton bale being swapped for all sorts of arms and weaponry in Havana, Cuba. And he realizes, and there, this is all coming out of New Orleans. He realizes, man, this really ticks me off. I got to do something about this. So he heads back up to Key West, again, expecting to meet his foster brother on the 18th of February. His brother's still not there. He gets mad again. He says, the heck with him, I'll go all without it. Heck with his mortars. I don't believe in him anyway. So on the 18th of February, he heads up towards Ship Island. Right off the Mississippi Gulf Coast, arrives there on the 4th of March, 1860. Gets there on the 20th of February, stays there until the 4th of March, waiting on his foster brother to show up. Foster brother's still not there, so on the 4th of March, he heads down to the Delta, Mississippi, or the mouth of the Mississippi River. Let's take a look at Porter. He doesn't leave Washington, D.C. until the 11th of February. I believe Farragut stays up there, as you can see. He shows up at Key West on the 28th of February, 10 days after his brother was there. So you see, he's running behind. and then shoots on up to Ship Island, gets there a week after his brother there on the 11th of March, one week after his brother's left. Now let's take a look. Fort Massachusetts at Ship Island. Farragut's there from the 20th of February to the 4th of March. Fort is not as complete as it is today at that time, but there is somewhat of a fort there. So, Farragut leaves a message when he leaves Ship Island on the 4th. You'll find me past La Hoot on the Mississippi anxiously awaiting your arrival. That's his way of saying, you know, I'm not happy. Anxiously awaiting your arrival. And Porter moves down, Farragut moves down. He can't get through Pass La Hoot. It's too shallow, so it goes all the way down the Southwest Pass. His goal is to get into the Mississippi River. There's three ways in Pass La Hoot, the Southwest Pass, the Central Pass, and to get into the river. But Farragut has the deep water ships with the deep hulls, and they've got a problem getting over the sandbar. They can't get through down there. Even though James Buchanan Eads has done some work, these are deep water ships with 22 guns on them, big, heavy, giant gunboats. Porter shows up at Fort Massachusetts, arrives there on the 11th of March. 17th of March, he heads out of the Pass La Hoot. 18th of March, because he's got these lightweight mortar schooners, even though he's got a big, heavy mortar on them, they're still small ships. And he's able to scoot right in Pass La Hoot, and he's in the Mississippi River waiting on Farragut. Now the tables have turned. Now the tables have turned. So, by the way, Ben Butler shows up on the 20th of March with his wife at Ship Island with 15,000 infantrymen. And these are the infantrymen who are eventually going to support this expedition. Farragut goes up and meets with Butler. Butler gives him a lot of coal. That helps Farragut. He needs coal for his steamboats, steamships. And so he gets coal from Butler. He says, isn't it illegal for you Army guys to give us Navy guys coal? And Butler says, I don't know the regs, so I don't know where you have it. So, Farragut's all right. So, on the 18th of March, you see Porter in the Mississippi River, and Farragut's out stuck on the sandbars. He's going to be there from the 18th of March to the 7th of April, trying to get his boats across. You can see Porter's little schooners are pulling them and towing them. You see this one here is towing. I think I've got watch them put them down here. We'll see Farragut. Notice what Farragut's got. Four sloops, side wheelers, three corvettes, 17 vessels. Porter has got 26 vessels. 20 of these are mortar schooners. 6 of these are gunboats. This is a big armada, folks. This is a lot of boats. Porter manages to pull his Farragut's men in with his mortar schooners. He finally gets Farragut's men across the bar and he sends a message to Gus Fox, Assistant Secretary of Navy. I never thought Farragut a Nelson or a Collingwood. Comparing him to, of course, the great British naval commander after Nelson goes down, Collingwood takes his place. So he's not being very complimentary of Farragut at this stage of the game. This is kind of, I'm telling you this because I want you to understand the psychological profiles of these guys as they're working against one another in the midst of all of this. So they finally get Farragut's fleet in on the 8th of April, 1862, into the Mississippi River. All right, let's take a look at Fort Jackson. The Confederates have built two forts, old forts that are there on the Mississippi River. Fort Jackson is a star-shaped fort. That's Fort Jackson today, the star-shaped fort. There's the plans for it. And I've got a nice aerial photo of Fort Jackson, taken right after Katrina, full of water. And if you superimpose it, you can see how accurately the design is over the actual fortifications. Farragut moves up on the 16th of April. And Porter, the main plan is Porter is going to pound these two forts into submission with these 13-inch mortars. It fires a 225-pound shell over 2 miles. So that's his game plan. And the 18th of April, the mortars move up in front of Farragut's gunboats. Take a close-up view of it. as your close-up map. There's Fort Jackson. Let's put it on top of the map where she should be. And down here are Carter's Mortar Schools. On Good Friday, 18 April, 1862, schooners, notice what they do is they take the sails down and they put all sorts of foliage on the mast to hide them. And commanding one of the divisions is Lieutenant Watson Smith. We're going to hear more about Watson Smith. If you talk about a guy who's not a Nelson or a Collingwood, it's Watson Smith. Watson Smith's going to come into play during the Yazoo Pass expedition. So remember the name Watson Smith for the Yazoo Pass expedition. We'll see Queen and Bridge for the other two divisions. These are your mortar boats firing in the open, fire in the darkness. Let's drop some rounds. You never know, I was an old artillery, would you? I just love dropping rounds, even on a power pole. So, Porter blasted away. He's told Wells and Fox that I can neutralize Jackson and St. Philip in 48 hours with those shells. And that meeting back in November, let's see how many rounds. 18th to 23rd of April. 16,800 rounds from the 18th to the 23rd of April, and neither fort surrenders. And Porter is a little embarrassed about this. And his foster brother Farragut is not happy at all. I haven't got time to wait on this position. I told you at the beginning I didn't like his mortar idea, but you'd already sold it to the Secretary of the Navy, and now I'm sitting around here for 5-6 days waiting on you to silence his forts, and you haven't done it. So the bad blood between the two of them is beginning to get kind of rough. So the 23rd of April, 1862, Porter, Farragut, and Ben Butler were meeting in the Hartford. And the game plan is that Farragut is going to run past these forts with his fleet to head for the mortars. Of course, the mortars are going to have to stay behind. Leading the attack is going to be Captain Bailey with the lead squadron. They wait until about 2 o'clock in the morning, on the 24th of April, 1862. Porter blasts away with his mortars. And here comes the Federal gunboats. And they get past. Now they're upriver. These are some of the paintings of passing the forts. As the bombshells crossed over each other and exploded in the air, it seemed as if a battle were taking place in the heavens as well as on the earth. Porter writes it well. He's very descriptive. And there are a lot of people who discount his works. His book called Incidents and Anecdotes. I'll tell you, they take it as a joke, but in all honesty, the more I dig into Incidents and Anecdotes, I believe he's pretty accurate. Oh, he's got some foolishness in there, but his Incidents and Anecdotes, particularly the body of expeditions, are pretty accurate. Okay, let's take a look at the evacuation of New Orleans. When the gunboats have passed the forts, all they got to do is head back to New Orleans, and Mansfield Lovell is commanding in New Orleans. Mansfield Lovell is going to be vilified by the South for giving up New Orleans. There are those who want to be a defender of him. I'm not one of them. Not necessarily for giving up New Orleans. He didn't have much choice there. My beef with Mansfield Lovell is the Battle of Corinth. We'll talk about that later on. He takes 3,000 men, all he's got, and he heads up to Camp Moore. And evacuates the city of New Orleans. That is a drawing of Camp Moore and a railroad. That literally runs right through there, the Greater New Orleans Jackson Railroad. Lovell is at Camp Moore. Lovell will then go up to Jackson, Mississippi. He'll send troops over to Vicksburg, and the first of his troops will arrive in Vicksburg on 5 May, 1862. So we're beginning to see how the troops are going to leave Vicksburg and get up here. New Orleans, get up here. He sends Brigadier General Martin Luther Smith from New York State, by the way, but he marries a good Southern gal, and she's going to tell him how the cow's going to chew the cabbage, so he's with the South. Smith moves over and arrives in Vicksburg on the 12th of May, 1862, and begins to work on trying to fortify the town while Lovell moves up to Jackson, Mississippi. So now we're beginning to see, we're finally after all, a night and a half, we finally got around to Vicksburg. Let's take a quick look about the capture of New Orleans. Remember, Porter is left below the forts, and he's still blasting away trying to silence them. And Farragut is taking his fleet. He's going to go up into the city of New Orleans. He's going to run past the guns of Chalmette, where the battle was fought in January of 1815 with Andy Jackson. The Battle of New Orleans. You know, in 1814, he took a little trip. I like the part where he powdered the gators behind him. Notice that movement in New Orleans? As they come into New Orleans, Farragut arrives here on the 25th of April, and he will send his officers in, Captain Bailey and Lieutenant Perkins. This is gutsy. They're by themselves. Walk through the streets of New Orleans, go see the mayor, demand the surrender of the city. Lots of hostile citizenry around. The mayor says, well, I really can't surrender. So they go up and they raise the flag over the U.S. Navy. Anyway, and the next day, a fellow named William B. Mumford tears the flag down. And then the flag is broken, torn up into pieces, and given out for souvenirs. And there's actually a piece of the flag still remaining in the back of Mumford. This will infuriate Ben Butler when he learns of this. That's the U.S. Mint today. It's a museum. There's a photograph of it. Finally, on the 29th of April, there will be a formal surrender of the city of New Orleans at City Hall. Ben Butler will move in with an infantryman on the 1st of May, and he and his wife will occupy the St. Charles Hotel. Butler will then really begin to alienate the people of New Orleans. There are lots of ladies in town who are insulting federal soldiers, and so Butler writes on the 15th of May, the famous, infamous woman's order, General Order Number 28, saying any woman that's being discourteous to federal soldiers will be regarded as a woman plying her trade. And so he's basically calling any mad woman in New Orleans a prostitute, and that really doesn't sit well in 1862. He actually has some women banished to Ship Island for being rude to soldiers. That leads to what today, this is great, a chamber pot with Butler's picture at the bottom of it. Butler will then capture William Mumford and hang him. They'll actually build some gallows off of the porch of the U.S. Mint where he took the flag down and hang him, publicly hang him on the 7th of June for tearing down the U.S. flag. That doesn't mean all our friends and lords. He will then take the statue of Andy Jackson, and on the side of the statue, he will chisel on there, the Union must and shall be preserved. And that really ticks off the people of New Orleans. This is what Harper's Weekly says about Butler. He has held New Orleans like a nut in his hand. He has played no foolish and wicked game of olive branches and swords. He knew that he had his foot in the den of the most malignant enemies. Butler himself says, the enemies of my country, unrepentant and implacable, I have treated with merited severity. Obviously, he's not a very popular man. Eventually, it would get so bad, he would treat the ambassadors and others in New Orleans so badly that he would end up being replaced. Okay, now the forts still haven't surrendered. But when they learn that New Orleans has been captured, Farragut is in New Orleans on the 25th of April. The forts decide, well, there's no need to hold out. We got enemy on both sides. New Orleans is gone. We have no line of communications. And Porter will accept the surrender of the two forts on the 28th of April, 3 days later, when they learn. Now, this is going to be a real snob here because Butler's men are in quarantine just up the river, and Butler is not invited to the surrender ceremony. This is a Navy ceremony, and Butler is furious about this. Oh, these Army forts captured by the Navy, and even though his troops did nothing, they were there quarantined, didn't do anything, he's very unhappy. So Porter writes a message to Secretary of Navy Wells. Never in my life did I witness such a scene of desolation and wreck as Fort Jackson presented. It was plowed up by the 13-inch mortars. The bombs had set fire to it and burned out all the buildings in and around the fort. What does Butler say? He writes a message to the Secretary of the Army. He says, I have taken possession of the forts, and I find them substantially as defensible as before their bombardment.
Oh, man, this bad blood between these two.
Porter is so ticked off, he sends a message to the Assistant Second Lady, Gus Fox. Butler did it all! If you could have seen the trouble I had getting old Butler and the soldiers up to the fort, you would laugh at the old fool's pretensions. Guys, this is official correspondence. That's a dirty email. You don't do that. That's going to come back to haunt you, man. Whenever you put in an email, I always ask myself the question, how could I stand it if this was on the front page of the Clarion Ledger tomorrow morning? You know, be careful what you say. And then this, so now here we are, all these years later, looking at this. Barr even commissions one of his engineers to do a drawing of the damage to the fort. Look at these shell holes. All these little marks are shell holes from 13-inch mortar shells. But the fort's still there. So he's trying to prove that he did a great job. Okay, New Orleans is falling. Now Farragut's going to move up the river. Porter is sent back to Ship Island with his mortars. So he's out of the picture. He's not happy about that. Farragut will move up to Baton Rouge. Arrives there on the 9th of May. Baton Rouge is the second Confederate capital to fall. Which one was the first?
Nashville. Yeah.
Nashville, you're paying attention. They move upriver. They get to Natchez, and they can't find but 17, some accounts say 14 men willing to defend the city, so there's nobody there. And they capture Natchez on the 12th of May, 1862. This has been easy for Farragut, so he shoots one up, and he gets to Vicksburg. And he sends Captain Samuel Phillips Lee up. First, there's Samuel Phillips Lee, Robert E. Lee's third cousin, and this was the question answer. They got Mike Gross in a ball cap. Samuel Phillips Lee goes upriver, arrives on the 18th of May. He's got 1,400 men with General Thomas Williams that Butler has loaned him, and five gunboats, and he demands the surrender of Vicksburg. The underside with orders from Flag Officer Farragut and Major General Butler. Remember those ranks. Flag Officer Farragut and Major General Butler. Just for a minute. You don't have to log them in permanently. Just remember them for about 5 seconds. Respectively demanded, yada, yada, yada. You see the whole deal. Here comes a message back from Martin Luther Smith. With 3,600 men, 18 guns, I have to reply that having been ordered here to hold these defenses, my intention is to do so as long as in my power, but they're not through. Here comes Colonel Autry. He says, Mississippians don't know and refuse to learn how to surrender an enemy. If Commodore Farragut, he's reduced him to grave, and Brigadier General Butler, he's reduced him to grave, you can't tell me that wasn't intention. He dropped them both to grave. Now, you know, military folks have got egos as big as weather balloons, and you drop them a grave, they really don't like it. Intention. Let him come and try. And then the mayor of Last Lindsay says, neither the municipal authorities nor the citizens will ever consent to a surrender of the city. So Samuel Phillips Lee has gotten three really slaps in the face, all in one packet. And he says, well, what the devil am I going to do? I ain't got my 1,400 troops. They got 3,600. I can't take this city. So he's up there on the 18th of May. Farragut's going to arrive on the 21st of May. And he's wondering, where is the ironclad fleet? Remember, the ironclads are supposed to be coming down the river. Where are they? What's going on? I need some help here. But they're not there. So on the 26th of May, Farragut withdraws. I got to go get some help. He comes back to Vicksburg with some help. Not as much as he wants, but he comes back. Arrives on the Brooklyn on the 18th of June, 18th of the vessel leadership on the Brooklyn on the 18th of June, a month later. Up the river comes Porter. Porter is showing back up. Porter has brought mortars with him. We'll teach these folks in Vicksburg. We'll bring some 13-inch mortars in here. Maybe a few 225-pound pills will help them out. 20th of June, 1862, they arrive. Down the river comes Brigadier General Alfred Ellet with the Ram Fleet. He's taking Charles's place, and he's down with the Ram Fleet. So now you've got boats above Vicksburg and boats below Vicksburg, actually. Boats above Vicksburg and ships below Vicksburg. And then up the river comes Farragut with Thomas Williams again. And they arrive on the 25th. So we're going to see here 3,200 troops, 17 schooners, 15 gunboats, 8 transports, and 5 rams. Not a bad hodgepodge. However, on the 27th of June, in comes Earl Van Dorn, the new commander of Vicksburg, with 14,000 troops and 30 guns. So you can see that these 3,200 infantrymen out there don't mean too much when you got 14,000 on the other side of the river. So that presents a problem. What is Thomas Williams going to do with his 1,400 men? Well, I can't attack the city, not if they got 14,000. Here they come, the Confederate troops again with their 14,000 troops on the 27th of June. So the same day, Williams is going to start working on the canal. The idea of Williams' canal, start digging the canal, let's have it show up across right through here. The idea is to dig a canal and cause the waters of the Mississippi to change course and leave Vicksburg high and dry. He uses mostly slave labor. They go out and get slaves from local plantations and they start digging a ditch about 6 feet deep and 6 feet wide. Look at the time of the year, folks. It's in June. Now, it's one thing to dig, but when you're digging through this, notice that there is a clear, look at these trees, these cypress trees and all this. Somebody cleared those trees out right through there. Not only have you got to dig, you've got to cut down the trees and then you've got to get the stumps out of the way. And that's tough. They bore holes in them, they put gunpowder in them, they do all these things, but the troops are beginning, the troops and the slaves are beginning to drop out like flies from this heat and this type of work. Farragut is then going to the side. What I'm going to do is take my fleet past the batteries of Vicksburg going north and get on the other side. Now, there are those who say, what was he trying to do by doing this? Is it just a show of bravado, or what is it he's trying to do? Remember that Ellet is on the other side over here with rams, and so some say he was actually trying to get over there and get supplies and coal, but they could have carried that across. I think it's just a show of bravado. He's ticked off. He's a type A. He's got to do something, so he's going to run his feet past the mountains. 3 o'clock in the morning. Now, admittedly, that's the USS Mississippi, which really, this painting is not that action, but it's a good painting of a ship getting fire coming in, so I wanted to use it. We'll talk about that picture later on. But notice, 3 of his boats turned around and came back. Now, these dark blue ones are porous mortars. 3 of his boats turned around and came back after all the fire started. I'll back it up and let you see it one more time. Watch him now. Three of them said, you know, I don't like this. And they turned around and came back. The USS Brooklyn, commanded by Captain Thomas Cravens, was the leader of that. Look at the size of that gunboat. 22 9-inch dolphins. For those of you who are familiar with the Vicksburg Military Park, Battery McPherson, that's a 9-inch Dahlgren at Battery McPherson, that huge gun. Imagine 22 of those on the boat. Gigantic. Tubes weigh about 9,000 pounds a piece. Farragut is furious that the Brooklyn, because Farragut was the first skipper of the Brooklyn back in the late 1850s when it was built. And now, his old command ship has turned around and hasn't run the battery with him. So he will relieve Captain Cravens. And he is no longer the commander of the group. That's Farragut. Now, Farragut is now north of the city on the other side of the Solar Peninsula. And he sends a message up to Flag Officer Davis, who's got the ironclads up in Memphis. He says, it's impossible for me to reduce the place without your assistance and that of the army. I need help. Davis is headed down the river. He gets this message on the 30th of June as he's moving down the river. So Davis sends a message back up the river to Ulysses Grant, who's Major General Grant, who is in Memphis now. He's gone over to Memphis while Halleck is in Corinth. And he says, it's naturally necessary to have additional troops occupy Vicksburg after Major Silence. May I request you to communicate this to General Halleck? So Grant sends a telegram to Halleck. On the 2nd of July, he gets a message, sends it over to Halleck in Corinth. Halleck in his usual method on the 3rd of July, 1862. By the way, Halleck was suffering from acute diarrhea. He called it the evacuation of Corinth. He says, Halleck says, the condition and weakened, the scattered and weakened condition of my troops make it impossible for me. A good commander never uses that word, by the way, impossible. When you see impossible in a sentence by a commander, you know he's not a commander. Impossible for me at the present time to detach any troops to cooperate with you on Vicksburg. That message goes back to Memphis and down the river to Farragut. He gets it on the 5th of July. He realizes, I'm not getting any help from the army. And to give you an idea of what Farragut must have said, we don't have a written record, but later on the Secretary of the Navy says, Halleck was good for nothing then, nor is he now. So this is written in January 63, talking about this. So, let's take a look at the situation. Davis is still headed down the river. Farragut is past the fleet. He's over here with Ellet's 5 rounds. Porter has got his mortars down here. We've got 3 of Farragut's boats down here. He's very unhappy with, but that was your place of commander. And there's Thomas Williams with his 1,400 grunts down here, still working on the canal. Here come the ironclads. Flag Officer Davis comes down the river, arrives. On the 1st of July, he's got the Benton, the Carondelet, the Cincinnati, the Louisville, and he's got some mortar scows with him. Look at this, he's got 4 ironclads, 6 mortar scows, 13 transports, but more importantly, he's got coal, tugboats, and food, which Farragut needs coal a lot. His boats are just as hungry as his men. So that helps him out a lot. And he's able to shift this across. Now these mortars will come into play. Remember, Porter's mortars are here, but they've got other mortars on both sides of the peninsula. Let me get your food back with me. There we go. With the mortars. Vicksburg catches rounds from both sides of the DeSoto Peninsula, but nothing really happens there. Porter is then ordered to Hampton Roads, Virginia, with his mortars. One of these mysterious moves. That's probably somewhere during that move is where one of his mortar scouts must have done a ground rim, I'm sure, at Davis Island, and that mortar ended up in the Mississippi River, and that's probably the mortar that's now at Grand Gulf today. It's probably during this move that Porter went downriver. But nobody records on losing a mortar, but it had to be. How else does a 17,000 pound mortar end up on Davis Island? Another ironclad arrives with Dirty Bill Porter, David Dixon's brother. Thursday shows up on the 13th of July. Dirty Bill's ironclad, if you remember, had been hit at Fort Henry and hit his steam drum and scalded him and a number of his men very badly. So he has taken the Essex, and without any proper appropriations, he has added all kinds of armor and protection to it, made it a very powerful ironclad. He's healed up, gotten his burns healed, and he shows up with the USS Essex now. So we've now got the 5 ironclads around over here. And then here we come with the lone Confederate gunboat. The rest of them have been destroyed, but up in Yazoo City, the Confederates have been building. Arkansas. And the Arkansas is commanded by as gutsy a guy as ever wore a uniform, Lieutenant Brown, Isaac Brown. This guy has got to have ice water in his veins for what he does. We'll see. They arrive on the 15th of July, 1862. Let me show you right quick the Arkansas. This is a contemporary, relatively contemporary painting of the Arkansas, but it leads you to believe the sides were slanted. Based on that, they're actually vertical sides. They didn't have slanted sides. You know, the cable of the ironclads has basically 45 degree slant. These don't have any slant at all. Let's show you a more accurate drawing of the Arkansas. This girl's just quite. Notice she's got big 8-inch guns in the bow, 64-pounder 8-inch guns. The chase guns on the 32-pounders on the stern, 2 32-pounders. Look here, 4 100-pound Columbiads. That's about a 9-inch Columbiad. These are big guns. six-inch Navy guns. This is a very, very powerful ironclad. Take a look at the length of 165 feet. What's the length? Anybody recall the length of one of the ironclads, these ironclads?
175.
175 feet. So this, the Arkansas is only 10 feet shorter than the Cairo or the each ironclad. Okay? But here's something. It draws 11 and a half feet of water. How much does the Cairo draw?
Six.
Okay, that's good news and bad. The bad news is you're liable to run aground in a shallow river, right? What's the good news? Think about it. If you've got a deeper hull, what does that give you? A more stable gun platform. A way more stable gun platform.
Right.
So it's going to make its gunnery more effective, but it's going to limit its maneuverability. There's always pluses and minuses here. Now, a telling feature of the Arkansas, notice it's got railroad iron, 4.5 inches of our railroad iron, 35 degrees slant on the bow of the stern, vertical on the port and starboard. But look at here. She travels at 8 knots. What's the max speed of an Eads ironclad?
Six,
if you're lucky. Cairo was the fastest of them. And the Cairo could push 6 knots. For some reason, they were all built the same as some, just like a car today, you know, how you break it down or whatever. The Cairo was a little faster than the rest of them. So it can outrun an Eads ironclad. If you can, the defense for an Eads ironclad would be the logical thing to do if you're going in a defensive mode, just try to go shallow water. Seems like to me, yeah. Okay. So here's the fleets. Here comes the Arkansas down the river on the 15th of July. Gone. Three boats or federal boats head up the river. They're looking for the Arkansas. They're going to find it, which they had. The Tyler, which is a timber clad, that's the cavalry. Remember, timber clads can do 12 knots. So she's out front. But you can't take an artillery round on a timber clad. It's 5 inches of oak. You can stop a bullet, but not a ram. So you can pop off an 8-inch gun, but you better get out of there. Before he returns fire, you got a problem. The Queen of the West is one of the rams. Commanded by Lieutenant Hunter. Gwynn has got the Tyler. Gwynn is a good officer. He will not survive the war. He will be killed later on, but he survived this day. Lieutenant Hunter, we can't even find a photograph of him because he's going to be relieved from his lack of duty performance on this particular day. The Queen of the West is a ram. And the USS Carondelet with the red banded smokestacks under Commander Wall, one of the 7 city class ironclads. These are the 3 boats that are going to run into the Arkansas. Now, if you're the commander of the Arkansas and you come up across 3 gunboats, a lot of folks would say, time to skedaddle. What does he do? Attack! Charges right into him. So let's put the Arkansas. Last away, of course, the Tyler has to skedaddle. The Queen of the West runs faster than anybody. And the Arkansas pulls up next to the Carondelet, grounds her. The Carondelet grounds. The Arkansas pulls up next to her. This is remarkable. The Carondelet grounds. The Arkansas doesn't. And the Arkansas then just pulls up next to her and gives her point-blank broadsides. And the skipper of the Arkansas swore that the Carondelet struck the colors when she ran. Walk says, I never did. So the Arkansas says, okay, we've already, they're surrendered, they're ours, and they head down the river. Let's get them down the river. And then he's going to run through the federal fleet as the other 2 boats get out, the Carondelet stays behind, and here comes the Arkansas running through the federal fleet and pulling up at Vicksburg. Red painting called Shave That Line of the Arkansas. What he's doing is pulling as close to the federal gunboats as he can so they can't depress their tubes. And he can blast into their wooden holes. And remember, this guy shoots and misses the Arkansas, guess who he's going to hit? A friendly boat or ship. So you don't want to do that. That's one of the drawings. Another painting that we see on the waterfront mural. It's a great painting. It's not particularly accurate. It's got the Arkansas fighting the Cairo, which wasn't there, in front of the city of Vicksburg, and they actually have one on the other side of the road. It's a great painting. I love it. But it's just not accurate, but it does what it's supposed to do. is get your attention about the medical battle here of July of 1862. Now, here's the situation. Farragut is over here, and is he ticked off? A Type A and a gunboat has run through his fleet, and he hadn't even had a steam up, so he can't do anything. And the Arkansas pulls up next to the port of Vicksburg, and down below, remember, those are the three of Farragut's boats that didn't run, and then you got Davis's ironclads over here. The Arkansas then shifts down to the Depot Street, to the end of Depot Street. Anybody have any idea why the Arkansas went down to the end of Depot Street? They're beat to heck now. They got bodies and body parts all over the boat. They've got buckets of sand thrown out to soak up the blood on the decks. The citizenry of Vicksburg run down to congratulate him, and then they recoil and hard at the gore on this boat. It's hard. But the skipper takes her down to Depot Street. Now, why would you go down to Depot Street?
What's on
Depot
Street?
Coal? Coal! They need coal! They got to go down to Depot Street and get the coal for the railroad depot. So they ship down to Depot Street. Okay? Then, to keep the Yankees guessing, he moves her up somewhere in the vicinity of where Glass Bayou comes in the Mississippi River, right there by the Mary Harbor. We don't know the exact spot, but let's just say it's right there in front of Mary Harbor. Now, Porter goes after him. What he does is he brings three of his ironclads up, and they open fire on four hill batteries. And he's going to have his fleet is going to run past the batteries of Vicksburg, and as they pass the Arkansas, they're going to sink it. But they can't see it. Their Arkansas has been painted with the only paint they had available, a rusty brown paint. And it's late in the afternoon, and she's against those lowest bluffs, and she blends in, and they can't see her. And very few of them get any shots off of her. So now Farragut finds himself bound south of the city again, and the Arkansas is still up there, and he's ready to go. I mean, you got to understand this man's mentality. And he can't stand the meaning of the word favor. And this, while the Arkansas is not really that significant a threat, it's a real thorn under his side, in his side, burr on his side. So, he comes up with another plan. He's going to go up to Arkansas again. He's going to have, the CSS Arkansas is going to shift up again. This is going to move a little further north up towards Fort Hill. And then, so keeping the Yankees guessing where she is. Because the Yankees down here, they're watching, they're reporting where she is, and she's moving back and forth. At dawn on the 22nd of July, the Essex and the Derbyville Porter is going to go attack the Arkansas. Notice the Arkansas shifted position. Her engines are out right now. So the skipper, this is gutsy, he's able to get enough crewmen on board to man two guns, his two bow guns. And he cuts the hawser line holding the bow and lets the current swing the boat out like that. And so he times it just right, so as the Essex comes around, the current pushes his bow around. And he gives Dirty Bill a whole lot more than he was expecting from those two big 64-pound bow guns and blasts into Dirty Bill Port. Davis sends his ironclads up, and they blast into Fort Hill again, blast away at Fort Hill. Dirty Bill's had all of the Arkansas where he wants. He goes south. Here comes the Queen of the West. Got a new skipper. Hunter's gone. She tries the same thing. The Arkansas gives her all she wants, and she heads south. Now you've got a ram and an ironclad separated from the rest of the ironclad and ram fleet. And they can't go back up the river because if they do, you've got an ironclad that travels at basically 6 knots against a 4-knot current. You're going to go 2 knots upstream, and other Confederates have got a lot bigger guns there than they had when Farragut first went up the river. They don't want to do that. So, you've got two of the ironclads. These are the ironclads and the rams that are going to show up at the Battle of Baton Rouge later on. That's why they're south from the rest of the fleet. Okay, Farragut's had all he wants. He's really disgusted. He could not sink the Arkansas. The Arkansas will go down and fight in the Battle of Baton Rouge and have to be scuttled. Of course, if you go to the south, he's gone. But on the 24th of July, Farragut heads back down to New Orleans. Why does he leave? What's the main factor here driving him south? The river falling. It's 24 July, and he's got a deep water fleet, and he's getting ready to get all of his boats grounded. So he pulls south.
on the 24th of July. That leaves Davis there on the other side of the Solar Peninsula with the iron fence he has left. Finally, on the 28th of July, he realizes all I'm doing is burning coal, and he heads up Brooklyn. And that Davis will handle back up in Memphis, Tennessee. Now, interesting thing. On the 15th of October, 62, Davis will be kicked upstairs to the Eastern Theater, so to speak. He'll be given a desk job as a naval engineer. And David Dixon Porter will take his command on the 15th of October, 1862, of the ironclad fleet at Cairo, Illinois. So Davis is out on the 15th of October. Okay, that wraps us up for tonight. I've got a question to throw at you for the next session, for those of you. Now, I'm going to do something different this time, because you know me, that those of you who live closest to me have the closest access to a computer have been answering first. So, what we'll do this time is, I'm going to pull the radio station up there. The fifth caller. The fifth email gets the prize. And the prize is none other than a magnificent, unworn battle-focused t-shirt. I mean, I have literally seen people shoot each other in bars over this shirt. The question is, I'll watch my computer, the fifth person to get an answer. Who said, my men will never dig another ditch for Halleck except to bury him? And I'll give you a hint. He has a statue in Vicksburg National Military Park. Where's David Maggio? He should be here tonight, because that's his forte.
He's out of town.
He's out of town. That's absolutely his forte. I mean, he can come up with the strangest off-the-wall information about statues. I love it. He's always coming up with some crazy things. It's great stuff. Okay. If you think you have the answer, email me, and the number 5 will get the t-shirt we'll present next week, or you can snail mail. And I really don't have a solution for snail mail. If I don't get an email correct answer, the first snail mail that gets to me will be the way. Okay. So postmark it or good email, whatever. Any questions here before we stack arms? We've had a long night. I appreciate your patience. There's a lot to cover tonight. We'll pick up next week. We're going to have a great small arms demonstration next week from Jeff Jambone. After we give a little lecture and have small arms demonstration. Yeah, Mike.
Have we not gotten to the Grand Gulf Battle and the Port Hudson?
No, we're not there. We're still in 62.
Okay.
I'm working my way to 62.
Okay.
We'll get you there. But I think it's very important to understand the maneuvering of these naval forces, and more importantly, these commanders, as we see who we're going to be facing. And you can understand these guys. The next time you pass the Union Naval Monument, you see David Dixon Porter and David Glasgow Farragut there. You know, you'll say, they did some serious work. They were foster brothers, but think about it. A lot of us, sibling rivalry. Okay. Any other points or questions here before we dismiss? Thank you for your patience. I will see y'all next week.
I'm going to